Well, what I'd like to do here is work through an example of finding or trying to find a circulation on a graph, a directed graph, that has demands and lower bounds on flow. So I've copied a directed graph that we solved for circulation with demands previously. And here was one solution that we found in a previous clip right here. And what I'd like to do here is just add a lower bound to one of these links. So let's just put a lower bound right here of 1. And the way we denote this is the capacity of the flow, which labels the link right here, will have an upper bound and a lower bound right here. And if there's only one number listed, that's the upper bound. If there are two numbers listed like so, then it's the lower bound and the upper bound. Okay, so the first thing we do to solve this problem is to essentially remove the lower bound. And in this case, for this example, I only have one link that has a lower bound for capacity for flow on it. The capacity specifies a lower bound, and that's this link right here. So the first thing I'm going to do is accommodate this link by getting rid of the lower bound. And the basic idea of getting rid of the lower bound is that you change the flow capacity and any supply and demands that you might have there for the source node and the destination node by assuming that you have the lower bound amount of flow going over that link. So I'm going to just redraw that link first to get us started here. The entire graph will be redrawn. I'm making a new graph. This is original graph G, and I'm making a new graph G prime that has this lower bound right here removed. So when I remove the lower bound by assuming that there is one unit of flow that goes through here, that's the same thing as saying that there is a maximum flow now allowed of 4, because I've already got one flow going through there. Since we're assuming there's one unit of flow going through here, that means I've used up one element of this supply right here. So since I've used up one element of this supply, I need to take my minus 4, which is my current supply, and bring that down to have less supply. So I'm going to take minus 4 plus 1 gives us a minus 3 amount of supply right there. Minus 4 plus 1 to give us our new supply. Similarly, right here, I will have supplied an extra unit of a source value, of demand value that I have to have right there. So that means I'll be changing this to 2 minus 1. Here it was minus 4 plus 1. Now it's 2 minus 1. So that will give us a demand left that I have to satisfy now, because by forcing one unit of flow through here, I will have satisfied one unit of this demand here. So here we've got like an invisible, a virtual one unit of flow. That means I've satisfied one unit of this demand, bringing us now to only one unit left that I have to satisfy, and I will have consumed one unit of supply, giving us one unit less of supply that I have to that has to be used. Okay, so that takes care of this link right here. The rest of the nodes and the links all just get copied over, and that makes our new graph. All right, so now what I have is just a network with demands on it. So we solve this then problem the way we solved it before, and that is to remove the demands and then find the maximum flow. So first let's remove the demands. So to remove the demands, let me just do it right here in place, because we've already seen what's going on here, so I don't have to be hyper careful. I draw my super source and a super sink, like so. And the capacity of the link from the super source to the source node is the demand right there. So this is 3, and this is no longer relevant here. And then again, I have 3. And here I have 1, because that's a supply. And here I have 5, because that's a supply. Okay, so demands are removed there. Next step is to find the maximum flow. And of course, to do that, I will use the Ford Fulkerson algorithm. Okay, so let's proceed with that. Take green. So I'm going to, again, do it in place as much as I can until we get confused. Then I'll start to actually draw the residual graphs out if I really need to. Okay, so let's see. My first augmenting path, let's say, will be SACT. Okay, SACT gives us a bottleneck of, let's see, I can go forward 3, 4, 1, bottleneck of 1. So 0 plus 1 gives me 1, 0 plus 1 gives me 1, 0 plus 1 gives me 1. Okay, next possible augmenting path, SBDT. SBDT. Let's see, bottleneck 3, 4, 5. So the bottleneck is 3. So I add 3 to each of these, 0 plus 3. 0 plus 3, 0 plus 3, okay. Next, let's see, I could go SACDT. S to A to C to D T. SACDT. Okay, so the bottleneck, let's see, I've got 2 to go forward there, 3 to go forward there, 3 there, and 2 there, so the bottleneck is 2. So I add 2 to each of these, so that's 1 plus 2 gives me 3. Here I have 1 plus 2 gives me 3. Here I have 0 plus 2 gives me 2. And then here I have 3 plus 2 gives me 5. Okay, and it looks like there's nothing else I can have come out of S, so I'm done. Nothing else to go into T. Let's just do a quick check here to make sure everything is okay. Not everything, but just do a quick test here. So coming out of S, I have 3 plus 3 is 6 units. Going into T, I have 1 plus 5 is 6 units. Since I'm finding a maximum flow on a regular network, any of my nodes has to also satisfy the conservation constraint. So coming into C here, I have 3 and 0, 3 plus 0 going in, and then going out of here, I've got 2 plus 1, so that matches. Into B here, I have 3 plus 0 coming in, so that's 3 coming in, and going out, I have 0 plus 3, so conservation satisfied there. Okay, so here is my maximum flow network right here. Now, in order to see that I've solved this problem right here, let us and what the actual flows on my original graph are, we have to undo the modifications we've made to the graph. So to undo the modification, we're going to, let's see, first thing we want to replace the demands. Okay, and first I can see right away that won't be a problem. There's no difficulty here because I've got this source, super source right here, had to supply 3 units, and we can see I supplied 3 units. Right there is my the actual flow. And here on this one, it had to supply 3 units into B. That's what B was supposed to be originating. And there's going to be those 3 units right there of flow. Similarly in C, I've got 1 out of 1 and 5 out of 5. So when I replace my demands, and I can just go ahead and do that, I'm not going to have any issues. So A will have minus 3, and then I've got 3 out of 4 to C, and C has 1 right here, and then B has 3, minus 3, because it's a supply, and then B to D, D has 5, and B to D is 3 out of 4. Okay, B to C is 0 out of 4, C to D is 2 out of 3, and A to B is 0 out of 4. Okay, and then the last step is to replace the lower bound. And I replace the lower bound by undoing what I did up there. Okay, so just to remind us, this right here is the link that had the lower bound on it, right here. Okay, so let me first redraw that link. So I'll have B to C, like so. Okay, now I assumed up here, to go from here to here, I assumed there was a flow of one being forced through already, so I didn't have to count that anymore, and that took away one from the capacity. So now I want to undo that. There's a flow of one that I've forced through to even start this, and the capacity is one more than this four. I'm replacing that flow, but I'm taking away that flow that I forced on to go from here to here. Okay. Now when I replace that flow across this link, when I took away the flow here, I modified my demands. Same thing, when I replace the flow, I have to modify the demands back. So here I'm replacing that flow. That means I've got one more supply here than what I had before. So that is minus 3 minus the 1 gives me minus 4. Okay. Here I've got one more supply that I assumed that I then one more supply that I have to put back in to my graph to take me back to the original graph. So it's 1 plus 1 gives me 2. Okay, and if in case that has you all troubled, this B minus 4 has to match this B minus 4 up here, because that's was the supply that I started with, and that took me to here. And then when I'm undoing that, I go from minus 3, and then I'm putting that flow back in. Sorry, I'm taking that flow back out. So, and same thing, this C is plus 2, that's got to match what I have up here. Okay, every other link is going to be the same. So we'll have minus 3A, 0 out of 4. And then A goes to C with 3 out of 4. C goes to D with 2 out of 3, and B goes to D with 3 out of 4. Okay, let us do a quick check here and make sure that I'm okay. So I've got a supply of 3 coming out of A, right here, supply of 3 coming out of A, and then the actual flow is 3 plus 1, so that matches. Coming into C, I have 3 plus 1. Going out of C, I have 2. So that's 4 minus 2. That gives us the 2 that has to sink into C. So C is okay. Coming out of B, I have 1 plus 4. So that's, sorry, 1 plus 3 gives me 4, and that matches the supply that B must give. Coming into D, I have 2 plus 3 gives me 5, and that matches the sink that D has to accommodate. So this graph right here is a solution. Now before I leave this problem, I've solved this problem, I have found for my original graph a circulation where I satisfied my demands, 1, 2, 3, 4 demands, and I satisfy this lower bound constraint right here on this one link. Okay, so all my demands are satisfied, and here I've got my flow is actually, notation is wrong, it went from 0 over 4 to 1 over 5. Okay, so that satisfies that flow. Let's pause for just a minute, though, and take a look at this other solution I found for circulation with demands. And this is down here, is circulation with demands and a lower bound, which is an increased constraint over this one right here. Okay, and you see that this solution right here, that I have right here, is a solution to the problem of this find a circulation with demands. It is a solution to that problem. It is a more specific, it's got more constraint on it, because I also have to find a lower bound of flow on this link right here, but this is a solution. So my point here is that when I found this solution right here, I found a solution. This algorithm does not find all solutions.